Nobody gets the faithful out of their wheelchairs these days any faster than Benny Hinn. And when Pastor Benny comes to town, no civic center is big enough.
God has just healed her!
Healed her of what, Pastor?
Polio!
This woman who said she had polio and would never walk again, she and her friends say she just climbed out of her wheelchair and walked?
It's a miracle! It's a miracle!
It's unbelievable!
Pastor Benny knows it's great TV, but does he know, does he care if these healings are genuine? Anybody could make up anything.
Someday somebody's going to do that. And what are you going to say then?
I don't know. I can't tell you now. It hasn't happened yet.
Oh, yes, it has. Remember that woman supposedly cured of polio? Pastor Benny knows it made for a great episode of his TV show. He knows it probably helped squeeze even bigger donations from his flock. But there's something he doesn't know.
That woman works for us. Woman doesn't have polio, never did.
Then why did she say she had?
We put her up there to see if he could tell her story was not true, to see if it would matter, to see if he would ever check. So, Benny, is it faith or is it fraud?
I'm still a human being like you. Made many mistakes, big ones, and will still make mistakes. But I really want to do better. I really want to.
The law is this. Here's the law in the kingdom of God. Harvest responds only to seed, not to prayer. Harvest responds only to seed, not to prayer, not to fasting, or any kind of position you have. Harvest only responds to seed. Say that out loud. Harvest only responds to seed, not prayer. Not fasting. Not titles. Seed. Now, don't you go to thinking about, well, no, I don't agree with that because I remember one time I prayed. No, it only responds to seed. All right, keep living. Living this time right now. Ain't no harvest coming because you say, oh, Lord Jesus, you understand. Lord, help me. He said, I do understand. So, don't start all that. So, find you some piece of money. Find you something to sow. If it's money, you need whatever the harvest is, you need to come up. If it's money, you're going to have to sow money. You can't talk about, I'm going to sow my time. You're just going to get a vacation. No money. Until the seed is sown, the harvest is not in view. Until the seed is sown, the harvest is not in view.
Phoenix, Arizona, hello.
Hello, Larry. You're the best. And thank you, Joel, for your positive messages and your book. I'm wondering, though, why you sidestepped Larry's earlier question about how we get to heaven. The Bible clearly tells us that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the light, and the only way to the Father is through him. That's not really a message of condemnation, but of truth.
Yeah, I would agree with her. I believe that.
So then Jew is not going to heaven.
No.
Well,
here's my thing, Larry, is I can't judge somebody's heart. You know, I don't know. Only God can look at somebody's heart. And so, I don't know. To me, it's not my business to say, you know, this one is or this one isn't. I'm just saying, here's what the Bible teaches, and I want to put my faith in, you know, in Christ. And I think it's wrong when we go around saying, you know, you're not going, because it's not exactly my way. I'm not going to be the God.
But you believe your way.
I believe my way. I believe my way with all my heart. But
for someone who doesn't share it, it is wrong, isn't it?
Yeah. I don't know if I look at it like that. I would present my way, but I'm just going to let God be the judge of that. I mean, I don't know.
So you make no judgment on anyone?
No, but
how
I...
About atheists?
No, I just, you know what? I'm going to let God be the judge of who goes to heaven and hell. And I just, again, I present the truth, and I say it every week, you know, I believe it's a relationship with Jesus. But you know what? I'm not going to go around telling everybody else. If they don't want to believe that, that's going to be their choice. God's got to look at your own heart. God's got to look at your heart. And only God knows that.
You believe there's a place called heaven?
I believe that.
So I just want to encourage every one of us to realize when we obey God, we're not doing it for God. I mean, that's one way to look at it. We're doing it for ourselves. Because God takes pleasure when we're happy. That's the thing that gives him the greatest joy this morning. So I want you to know this morning, just do good for your own self. Do good because God wants you to be happy. When you come to church, when you worship Him, you're not doing it for God, really. You're doing it for yourself because that's what makes God happy. Amen. Let's open our hearts to Him today.
But you need your own mentality. So when you grapple with this notion of many paths to God, there has to be many paths to God because we are many people. Right. And in the process, He reveals Himself in many ways.
And He has to reveal at your level, and not everybody's at the same level.
Not everybody's at the same level.
Not everybody's
at the same level. That's absolutely right.
Yeah.
That cross-pollinization that we talked about, that we are strengthened through.
I pray the power of God all over you. I pray His favor. I pray the blood of Jesus will come upon you right now. Keep you in His care. God, I thank you for your blessings.
He's talking to Donald Trump, by the way, and Donald Trump is, you know, all about money. And he endorses Paula White. But listen to this.
So we talk about that.
You know, that's the principle I teach, that find your passion in life and figure out a way to make money.
Well, I think that's...
Can you believe that?
Because my Bible tells me that John saw in the book of Revelation a multitude no man could number, of every tongue, of every nation, of every tribe, which no man could number, but nothing is said of that in terms of those who go to hell. It seems like there are more going to heaven. Whoa, hallelujah! And I think this church, this ministry has a lot to do with that.
This is exactly what the scripture meant when it said that people are going to amass to themselves false teachers, having itching ears, no longer wanting to hear sound doctrine. We see these stadiums are packed with people wanting to hear Joseph Prince say that everybody's going to be going to heaven. More people will be in heaven than are in hell. Listen, he does not know that. He doesn't know it, and he doesn't get that from Scripture. Just because there is an absence on the amount of people that are going to be in hell doesn't mean anything. When we look at Scripture, we see that Jesus says in Matthew 7:13-14, "Enter ye in at the strait gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat, because strait is the gate and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it." Now, Jesus' words say, "Few there are that find the gate that leads to eternal life." But broad is the way and wide is the gate that leads to destruction. Why is he saying this? Because there are many, many, many people that are going to reject the true gospel of Jesus Christ and go the way of this world.
I want you to go to the phone, dial the number on the screen, and simply say, "I'm one of the 1,000. I'm going to faith in somehow in 90 days a $1,000 seed." You may already have the 1,000. It may be something you put aside for retirement or a college or a vacation. You may have put some money aside that nobody knows about and God's given you a picture. It may be in the bottom of your closet. It may be in a sock. Maybe between your mattresses. It may be an account that nobody knows about but you and God. That's not your harvest. That $1,000 won't get you anywhere until God touches it. Everything.
In fact, I have a feeling that somebody watching me right now, I have a feeling that somebody that wants a credit card debt wiped out, that if you'll use your faith as you sow the 1,000 on a credit card, as you use your faith, God's going to wipe out your credit card indebtedness. It is done. In Jesus.
Newspapers have flown helicopters over my house, taking pictures of my house. I didn't know how nice it was till I saw how my enemies saw it. And when I saw what they were looking, I said, wow, I am blessed. I am blessed. I didn't know how good God had been to me. Your $1,000 cannot reproduce until it enters into a covenant with the soil. You can put that $1,000. Just the other day I like new money. I don't know if you do, but I hate old money that's wrinkled and dirty and got all the diseases on it. I like new money. And when I give things to people, I like to give stacks of money. It's fun. You ever had a stack of new money? Have you? You have it? Have you?
A little stack.
A little, oh. And so I made, you know, the big stack where it was brand new, and I like brand new money. I don't want any money around me that's not. I'd almost rather have a new one than an old 20. Now that's kind of dumb, isn't it? But there's something about new money that excites you. You like $100 bills?
Oh yeah, I like new money too.
Oh, most beautiful thing on earth is a $100 bill. I hadn't seen a woman as good looking as a $100 bill. There's something about a $100 bill that excites you. So anyway, I gave it to her just because I did it to my sister. She took off the other day for somewhere, and so as she went to leave, and I went out to her, and her and her husband, I said, sis, I just want to give you a stack of money just to feel good, just to feel good, just stroke it. And he said, we don't give to get something back. Oh, yes, we do. Oh, yes, we do. A man came to me and said, Brother Mike, when I give to God, I expect nothing in return. I said, I wrote a little song for you. How dumb thou art. How dumb thou art.
Something. Adam in the Garden of Eden was God manifested in the flesh.
No denying some people have prospered handsomely.
Wow!
The pastors themselves. They live like rock stars with huge mansions, private jets, and fancy cars.
Oh, yeah!
But when it comes to opulence, few religious leaders compare to Kenneth Copeland.
Amen.
To show you his house, we rented this helicopter so you can see his 18,000 square foot mansion valued at over $6 million.
He lives in this home outside Fort Worth, Texas. It has beautiful water views and comes complete with a boathouse. But that's not all. Copeland is an avid pilot, and here's his pride and joy, a $20 million Cessna Citation jet. It's the fastest private jet money can buy. He said he needed it to better serve the Lord, and proudly did a flyby for his followers after the church bought it.
Shout amen!
But it's not just one plane. We found a fleet of planes registered to the church. And you won't catch him waiting in line at the airport because he's got his own, the Kenneth Copeland Airport, located right next to his mansion.
I think Copeland is unbelievably greedy.
Amen.
She sent them a lot of money, a whole lot of money.
When Christy Parker's mother died of cancer, she found diaries that showed her mother sent Copeland most of her life savings, hoping her faith and donations would cure her of her terminal disease.
What do you think of Kenneth Copeland's lifestyle?
TV doesn't do it justice. Their office furniture is probably worth more than most people's houses. It makes you sick.
Oh, amen.
My lifestyle follows the scripture. We give, we believe. We're open.
You have a fleet of private jets. Why is that necessary? You're a minister. How many private jets do you have?
We're going to have to go. That is not your business. We're open. We're open.
Right after that, he walked away.
Although Copeland says he cooperated with the Senate investigation, the Senate committee disagreed, saying only two television preachers did, Joyce Myers and Benny Hinn. And the committee recommended that the IRS investigate further.
Amen. Amen.
C'è chi ritiene di poter avere un rapporto personale, diretto, immediato con Gesù Cristo al di fuori della comunione e della meditazione della Chiesa. Sono tentazioni pericolose, sono tentazioni dannose, sono...
And if at times our efforts and works seem to fail and not produce fruit, we need to remember that we are followers of Jesus Christ, and his life, humanly speaking, ended in failure, the failure of the cross.
Mature and develop godly character until we learn to live with the all-seeing eye on us all the time. I mean, we're never going to mature and develop godly character until we learn to live with the all-seeing eye on us all the time. I mean,
it's a story that is shocking many Americans on this night. One of the country's most famous Christian pastors is being accused of having sex with members of his church, and not just any members. We're talking about teenage boys he may have met when they were as young as 14, and then, according to the allegations, may have had relationships with them after they turned 16 and above. In a lawsuit, two men in their 20s now are saying the bishop, Eddie Long, took them on trips, gave them gifts, bought them a car, gave them cash, gave them jewelry, all as a ploy to have sex with them. And they say it was the church's money that he was giving to them. His lawyer is denying the allegations, but I want you to listen to some of the most graphic details in this lawsuit, straight from the attorney who shocked many tonight when she stood before cameras and told this story of Eddie Long. Here she is.
There, the pastor started to do what adult pedophiles do with younger people, which is starting to spend time with them, casually watch TV with him and lay his legs on him, and then ask him to massage him, and then start explaining to him how special he was to him, and it was special for the bishop to be able to spend time with them. They did devotional readings together. He was over there on a regular basis at this house. Eventually, it turned into such a relationship that the bishop had a ceremony with Anthony Flagg called a covenant. Within that covenant, it was essentially a marriage ceremony where there was a candles, exchange of jewelry, and biblical quotes given in order for Anthony to know and for the bishop to tell him, "I will always have your back and you will always have mine." He would use biblical stories to talk about how important it was to follow your leader and your master, and let him know that the acts that he was engaged in were not necessarily meaning that he was a homosexual or that either of them was, but rather the pastor, Bishop Long, was releasing his passion and his love for Anthony. Meantime, we have Maurice Robinson, and while Anthony's living in this house, he's bought a Mustang car. He's given money. He is on the payroll of New Birth Missionary Baptist Church, as reflected by the federal tax returns. And he starts to travel with the bishop. He goes to the W Hotel in New York Times Square. He goes to the W Hotel in Dallas, where Anthony specifically remembers that he saw the zoo in town and that he wished he had gone to the zoo. But instead, on that trip, he accompanied the bishop everywhere the bishop went, including sharing a bed in the same hotel room on that trip and many others. They joined this church,
And the next thing he knows, he starts to immediately get to know the bishop. And the bishop, this is a very handsome young man, very charismatic young man, who wants nothing more to do what a lot of young African-American males want to do, like their idols of being in the music business, perhaps. And he introduces him to famous people. He meets T.I. He meets Chris Tucker. He meets Tyler Perry. He meets all kinds of famous people in the company of Bishop Long. And Bishop Long gives him a car. In fact, Bishop Long lets him drive his Bentley automobile. That's right. Bishop Long has a Bentley, or the church does, whoever owns it, and allows a young man at 17, 18 years old to drive it around. The feeling of power. And he gives him money, and he puts him on the New Birth missionary payroll, which again will be reflected by the 1040 forms that he received. And in fact, Anthony has, just in the accounting and the payroll, over $11,000 of payments on the payroll from New Birth Bishop, New Birth Church, as an employee of a 17 or 18 year old young man. And that's not counting the cash, the gifts, and the trips. He too went on a number of trips, but for Maurice, he was a little bit tougher because his mother and father were both in his life, and yet his mother recounts how the bishop, she thought there was nothing better for her son in their entire life to be handpicked as a personal attendant around the bishop. Crossing the line in which you have sexual contact of any sort with your parishioners, and particularly vulnerable young men that you're supposed to protect. It's our belief that these two are just two of the brave ones who are willing to come forward. And I'm gonna tell you now, y'all are gonna be chasing them around for interviews, and I'm not putting them through that. For them to sit down and reach out and tell me what happened, and it is the gory details in this complaint of the sexual acts that occurred, is more than enough, and we did not hide their names. This is not a John Doe lawsuit. But at the same time, they don't need to be in front of cameras.
The well-known sex scandal involving Bishop Eddie Long began when four young men, all former members of the New Birth Missionary Baptist Church, filed suit accusing the bishop of lavishing money, trips, and gifts on the young adults while having sexual contact with them.
You are not a man, you are a monster.
The case was finally settled in secret back in May. Sources tell us an undisclosed amount of money was paid to the young men about anything else.
We wanted to ask you about Bishop Eddie Long.
Oh,
no comment.
Come on.
Can we just talk to you for a second?
But I am not the man that's being portrayed on the television.
The well-known sex scandal involving Bishop Eddie Long began when four young men, all former members of the New Birth Missionary Baptist Church, filed suit accusing the bishop of lavishing money.
No, not because they're gay. Everybody, we go to hell because we choose to reject the grace of God. The only way you can go to hell is
if a gay person accepts Christ.
Jesus Christ. He's going to heaven.
Okay.
Without a doubt.
Okay.
And by the way, if you're not following me on Twitter, you're going to hell.
I'm going to say something going to knock your lights off. God has the power to take life, but he can't. He got the power to do it, but he won't. He's bound. He can't. He says death and life is in the power of whose tongue? Yours. You ready for this? You want something to knock your lights off? You choose when you live. You choose when you die. Death and life's in the power of your tongue. Not God's. Now, he's got the power. But he will not exercise that because you are a speaking spirit. So he says, speak life. He even tells him, choose life. It's death and blessing, man. Let me help you out. Let me help you. Life.
Tell me, what do you think is the future of Christianity? Well, Christianity and being a true believer, you know, I think there's the body of Christ, which comes from all the Christian groups around the world, or outside the Christian groups. I think everybody that loves Christ or knows Christ, whether they're conscious of it or not, they're members of the body of Christ. And I don't think that we're going to see a great sweeping revival that will turn the whole world to Christ at any time. I think James answered that, the Apostle James, in the first council in Jerusalem, when he said that God's purpose for this age is to call out a people for his name. And that's what God is doing today. He's calling people for out of the world for his name, whether they come from the Muslim world or the Buddhist world or the Christian world or the non-believing world. They are members of the body of Christ because they've been called by God. They may not even know the name of Jesus, but they know in their heart that they need something that they don't have, and they turn to the only light that they have, and I think that they are saved and that they're going to be with us in heaven.
This is fantastic. I'm so thrilled to hear you say that. There's a wideness in God's mercy.
There is.
There's a wideness.
The Master had special plans for us.
Why is he holding a picture of Billy Graham? For those of you who have discernment and have studied and are paying attention to the end times deception and the falling away of the faith and all that's been prophesied in the Bible, you know who Billy Graham is and what Billy Graham's all about. He's the greatest Christian deceiver in human history, fulfilling Bible prophecy of the men that are falling away from faith, coming into the churches as wolves in sheep's clothing. If you don't know that, you need to do your research, or you're never going to be able to put these pieces to the puzzle together. I was so convinced by John Ramirez's testimony that I believed that he was a true convert. And in his testimony, he is revealing and disclosing that he was one of the highest level Satanists in the world. And he knew the names of principalities and powers of New York, Miami, Tahiti, Las Vegas, all around the world, the ones and the powers and the angels and the demon forces that controlled Islam and Buddhism and Hinduism and Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons and all these principalities and powers. And he's known them by name. He said he had contracts with them. You can't tell me that this man does not have any knowledge at all about the principalities and powers that work in the churches as false ministers of righteousness. You can't tell me he had no knowledge and the names of those principalities that are working with Billy Graham, the ones that gave Billy Graham his power, his fame, his prestige, and all the opportunities that made him a very famous and rich evangelist. You can't tell me that this man, his high-ranking level of Satanism and all the names and powers that he was familiar with and all the contracts that he had no knowledge of the Billy Grahams that are in the world. He's busted. He's busted. And only those who continue to support false teachers like Billy Graham are going to be deceived by these kinds of false Christian converts, such as these Satanists posing as Christians. They are nothing more than ministers of unrighteousness posing as godly men to deceive the masses. Beware of this kind of thing. Pray and fast for wisdom and knowledge and discernment so that you're not sucked into this strong delusion that God's pushing into the world. Only the elect will be spared. People like us who know the truth, who love the truth more than men. Do not be deceived by these things, brothers and sisters. Pay attention.
You better pray that you have the wisdom and discernment of God.
The Master had special plans for us.
Because you're going to need it as armor in these days of mass deception.
The Master had special plans for us.
Pray now. Fast now. Get what you can get from heaven now and strap it on and be ready and alert.
The Master had special plans for us.
Because this is going on in a major way. And I was amazed I believed him at first. And then praise God, hallelujah, by his grace and mercy. He opened my eyes. He opened my eyes to see this manipulation. He opened my eyes. He opened my eyes. He opened my eyes. What makes you think he can't trick you? He can't trick you. Trick you. Trick you. Trick you. Trick you.
The Master had special plans for us in our lives. Special plans for us.
Have you ever wondered what the secret is behind T.B. Joshua's prophecies? Is he speaking the word of God? Is he given these visions from an evil spirit? Or are they just cleverly manipulated and edited to make them appear more accurate than they really are? In this video, we can reveal some of the editing tricks behind T.B. Joshua's prophecies. T.B. Joshua's video editing team are able to use footage of T.B. Joshua to stitch together prophecies to fit events after they happen by cutting out any inconvenient details that don't fit reality. They present these prophecies as if they were complete and untampered. In this video, we will show you how they work. Let's watch one of his recent prophecy videos, released on May the 12th, 2012, after a plane crash in Indonesia. It starts with an undated clip from a Sunday service.
The picture was so clear. The whole thing was like I'm watching a man on TV. If I don't see vision clear, I don't talk. I was praying, I saw in Indonesia. I want to advise them, there is a plane coming to the Indonesia, big one, that will carry passenger. I see crash. The color of the plane, I see blue. The picture of the plane was showing me and where it will take off, to the direction when it will happen, and the day and time. I'm seeing Wednesday. I say Wednesday. What will happen Wednesday?
It seems like a pretty clear vision. He mentions several specific details. A crash, a blue plane, a plane coming to Indonesia. The accident happens on a Wednesday. And on May the 9th, an accident happened.
44 passengers has gone missing during a demonstration flight over Indonesia.
It seems impressively accurate. Several details match the event. But here's where it gets interesting. A year ago, Scone released another video. It also predicted a plane crash, also in Indonesia. He's wearing the same black and white shirt that he was wearing in the 2012 video, and his words are at times identical to his new prophecy. It's the same video. Did Scone just reuse the same prophecy for two different disasters? Not quite. Actually, they've done something even sneakier. Let's see what he said back then.
Today now, I was praying, I saw in Indonesia. I want to advise them, there is a plane that will carry passenger. I see crash. The whole thing will start from sea. You will see the whole thing begin to sink. The picture was so clear. The whole thing was like I'm watching a man on TV. The color of the plane, the picture of the plane was showing me and where it will take off, to the direction when it will happen. I begin to picture the whole thing just like that.
The plane will sink into the sea. It was a passenger plane, though he didn't specify that it was big. He saw the color of the plane, but he doesn't tell us what it was. He saw when it crashed, but we don't hear a day specified. After this, the video reveals that a plane carrying 27 people did crash into the sea in Indonesia. But by now, we know that we're not seeing the whole prophecy. In the 2012 re-edit, we've seen different parts of exactly the same prophecy used to claim credit for predicting a completely different disaster. So in the 2011 version, why mention seeing the colour of the plane but not tell us what colour it was? Remember the clip we saw in the 2012 re-edit?
The colour of the plane, I see blue.
But here's footage from the wreckage of the plane that crashed in 2011. No sign of blue, but hey, no problem. TB Joshua's editing team can just cut that out.
The colour of the plane, the picture of the plane was...
In May 2011, he said that he saw the time it would happen, but he didn't tell us when it would. Why not? Let's look at the missing bit from the 2012 edit.
Where it will take off, to the direction when it will happen, and the day and time. I'm saying Wednesday, I say Wednesday.
Except the plane crash in 2011 happened on a Saturday. Whoops, better cut this bit out too.
The picture of the plane was showing me and where it will take off, to the direction when it will happen. I begin to picture the whole thing just...
In the 2012 re-edit, TB Joshua said,
to the Indonesia, big one, that will carry passenger.
But the 2011 crash was an MA-60, a small passenger plane.
A plane that will carry passenger.
If we took all the details that TB Joshua mentioned on the day that he wore his black and white shirt, the prophecy would not fit either one of the disasters that Scone claimed he predicted. So if you've ever been impressed by TB Joshua's prophecy videos, remember that the prophecies that we see are almost certainly not the full versions. They're patchwork prophecies, short, vague sentences that are stitched together in the Scone editing suite to suit whatever disaster happens to occur first. These videos are proof of this. Don't take our word for it. See the two complete videos for yourself and make up your mind. You'll find the links in the information below this video. This leads us to the crucial question. What is the purpose of these prophecies? If they were genuine, they could have been used to avert the disasters. After all, he claimed to have seen the day and the location of the crash. But now we know that he had no idea. All we can conclude is that he was simply exploiting these tragic events for the purpose of making a name for himself. We believe that this is extremely cynical and distasteful, an insult to those who've lost loved ones through this tragedy. We believe that it's an abuse and a mockery of the biblical gift of prophecy. And finally, we believe it shows the contempt that TB Joshua has for the people who follow him. If you agree, why not share this video on Facebook and Twitter and let everyone know the real secret behind TB Joshua's prophecies?
Man of God, I might lack word, but I know you are God in the flesh. Honestly, that's my conviction. Since I came, I've seen it in another way. I've seen it in another way. I see the place as an institution, your life and your word. No man can see you on the road and believe that you're a Holy Ghost machine.
Bamidele are a rarity. He doubts the claims of the televangelists.
Somebody that has never learned, been able to hear or speak, starts speaking English after 35 years of being deaf and dumb. And people believe this stuff. And they drop money for this stuff. It's wrong. All we do is tell people it is okay to ask questions. It's okay to be different. It's okay to question the things that you've grown, you know, you've grown in, you know, you've believed in all your life.
Ahmed says he was paid around $150 by a preacher to pretend to be a man who couldn't walk and then be healed.
The pastor took olive oil, prayed to the olive oil, just split the olive oil on me. I started, you know, all those things. It's a lie. But the congregation didn't know anything. They were thinking it's a miracle, but to our own side, it's a business.
He likes to be addressed as Emmanuel, God with us. These people are on an ego trip, and he likes to have the song sung, Emmanuel, our God. It's repeated over and over, Whilst driving out a demon, Joshua asked the demon, "And who am I?" And the demon answered, "You are Jesus the Christ." Joshua laughed and called others and said to him, "Hear what this demon says. I am Jesus." I've seen enough. Did you see how she walked? Like this. What happened when Jesus healed someone? He jumped up and jumped for joy and he was fully healed. This is deception of the highest order. 2 Thessalonians chapter 9 verse 11 reads, "The coming of the lawless one will be in accordance with the work of Satan, displayed in all kinds of counterfeit miracles, signs and wonders, and in every sort of evil that deceives those that are perishing. They perish because they refuse to love the truth and so be saved." What's the truth? Jesus is the way, the truth and the life. All thy commandments of truth, thy law is truth, Psalm 119. Obedience and Christ, that is the way. Jesus calls us to repentance and a walk with him. And then, you know why? Even if you stayed crippled, you have joy. Because you'll have life eternal and you will not be a cripple on the other side. For this reason, God sends them a powerful delusion so that they will believe the lie. This is God's permissive will. This, you must understand, God's will is God's will, God's permissive will, God's ultimate will. God permits it because they refuse to want him. They want their needs filled. Leave me alone with your repentance. Just give me what I need. And they are served this up in a package which is so delusionary that people believe it, so that they will be condemned who have not believed the truth, but have delighted in wickedness, wolves in sheep's clothing. For God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints. 1 Corinthians 14, verse 33. I would like to make an appeal that we serve Jesus Christ in righteousness and in truth. That we look at our own hearts and say, am I really a good, wonderful person? Or have I got faults? Is there one here who has not sinned? Is there one here who has never done anything that needs forgiveness? Is there anyone here who has not suppressed someone else for his own purposes? Is there anyone here who has not manipulated someone else for his own purposes? I doubt it. We all need the Spirit of Jesus Christ, total, unselfish love. Only Jesus can give it. And when I come to church, I come to church because I'm grateful. And I'm grateful to Jesus. And I come to church not to have my needs filled. I don't want to be a bread and fish Christian. Bread and fish God will provide if I serve him. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. And my God shall take care of all your needs. I've had many times of poverty in my own life. I've been in situations where I've literally faced death by violence many times. People who don't live in my country don't even understand that. But I know what it means. Trust God. I've learnt it by experience. And I know he comes through every time. He has a bad habit of coming through in the last second, but he comes through every single time. And why does he allow things to go to the last second? So we learn to trust him, no matter what the situation. You know what? I've come to love his character. He never ever forced me to do anything. Never ever ever in all my life has Jesus Christ forced me to do anything. Never. That is why if I should ever have the privilege of kneeling before him, I would take the crown and throw it at his feet. Why? Because I don't deserve it. He deserves it. And what will he do? He says, nah, you have it. And he will never remind me of anything that he did for me. Salvation in Christ is so complete that we stand one day before God as though we had never sinned. Our sin will be removed from us as far as the east is from the west. If you ask him, what have I done? He says, I can't remember. We will never feel like nothing when we are with Christ. We will be sons and daughters of God.
Let me share with you something that I see in the youth group, but I also see in the church at large, individual congregations. Because we have dumbed down the gospel, because we're not preaching the true gospel, and we are using carnal means to attract people. If you use carnal means to attract men, you're going to attract carnal men. And you're going to have to keep using greater carnal means to keep them in the church. So what has happened is this. We have these large churches filled with many unconverted carnal people. But in those churches, we also have this small group of people that honestly want Christ, and they honestly want His Word, and they honestly want to be transformed. They don't need anything else. All they need is true worship of the true God and Scripture being preached to them and lived out before them. That's what they want. Now, I want to tell you the great sin of the American pastor, and this has got me in a lot of trouble, but it's true. This small group of converted people in that local church, all they want is Jesus. And all they want to do is the right thing. They want purity. They want truth. They want Christ. But the pastor, in order to keep this larger group of unconverted people, he caters to them. So while he is feeding these carnal men and women with carnal things, he is letting the sheep of God starve to death, and he is going to stand before God one day in judgment. Listen, brother, if my wife was going grocery shopping, and when she was going out to her car, some men assailed her, attacked her brutally, and you walked by, and you did not want to get involved because you didn't want to cause trouble, you didn't want to put yourself in harm's way, you just wanted everything to go smooth. After all that was done, I would look for those men to deal with them. But I want you to know this, I'd look for you too. Because you had a chance to stand for my wife, my bride. And out of self-preservation or wrong ideas, you did not do it. You're just as much responsible as those men who attacked her. And that's what's happening all throughout America with pastors. It's the bride of Christ. There are sheep in all these churches, many of them, even churches that seem somewhat heretical in places. You'll usually find a group of people who truly want Christ, but the leadership is catering to the carnal and letting the bride of Christ starve to death, impoverished. And that is wrong, and there's going to be judgment for it. And the same thing is happening to the youth. I know young people that say, you know, Brother Paul, I listen to you all the time. And I said, well, what about your church? He goes, well, they don't preach this. It's not what the other young people want. And so they give them what they want. I'm starving to death. A little child of God, it would be better than a millstone be tied around your neck.
The whole thing was like I'm watching my TV. The color of the plane, the picture of the plane was showing me and where it would take off. To the direction when it will happen. I begin to picture the whole thing just like that.
The plane will sink into the sea. It was a passenger plane, though he didn't specify that it was big. He saw the colour of the plane, but he doesn't tell us what it was. He saw when it crashed, but we don't hear a day specified. After this, the video reveals that plane carrying 27 people did crash into the sea in Indonesia. But by now, we know that we're not seeing the whole prophecy. In the 2012 re-edit, we've seen different parts of exactly the same prophecy, used to claim credit for predicting a completely different disaster. So in the 2011 version, Why mention seeing the colour of the plane, but not tell us what colour it was? Remember the clip we saw in the 2012 re-edit?
The colour of the plane, I say blue.
But here's footage from the wreckage of the plane that crashed in 2011. No sign of blue, but hey, no problem. TB Joshua's editing team can just cut that out.
The colour of the plane, the picture of the plane was...
In May 2011, he said that he saw the time it would happen, but he didn't tell us when it would. Why not? Let's look at the missing bit from the 2012 edit.
Where it will take off, to the direction when it will happen, and the day and time. I'm saying Wednesday, I say Wednesday.
Except the plane crash in 2011 happened on a Saturday. Whoops, better cut this bit out too.
The picture of the plane was showing me and where it will take off, to the direction when it will happen. I begin to picture the whole thing just like.
In the 2012 re-edit, TB Joshua said,
to the Indonesia, big one, that will carry passenger.
But the 2011 crash was an MA-60, a small passenger plane.
A plane that will carry passenger.
If we took all the details that TB Joshua mentioned on the day that he wore his black and white shirt, the prophecy would not fit either one of the disasters that Scone claimed he predicted. So if you've ever been impressed by TB Joshua's prophecy videos, remember that the prophecies that we see are almost certainly not the full versions. They're patchwork prophecies, short, vague sentences that are stitched together in the Scone editing suite to suit whatever disaster happens to occur first. These videos are proof of this. Don't take our word for it. See the two complete videos for yourself and make up your mind. You'll find the links in the information below this video. This leads us to the crucial question. What is the purpose of these prophecies? If they were genuine, they could have been used to avert the disasters. After all, he claimed to have seen the day and the location of the crash. But now we know that he had no idea. All we can conclude is that he was simply exploiting these tragic events for the purpose of making a name for himself. We believe that this is extremely cynical and distasteful, an insult to those who've lost loved ones through this tragedy. We believe that it's an abuse and a mockery of the biblical gift of prophecy. And finally, we believe it shows the contempt that TB Joshua has for the people who follow him. If you agree, why not share this video on Facebook and Twitter and let everyone know the real secret behind TB Joshua's prophecies.
Man of God, I might lack word, but I know you are God in the flesh. Honestly, that's my conviction. Since I came, I've seen it in another way. I've seen it in another way. I see the place as an institution, your life and your word. No man can see you on the road and believe that you're a Holy Ghost machine.
Bamidele are a rarity. He doubts the claims of the televangelists.
Somebody that has never learned, been able to hear or speak, starts speaking English after 35 years of being deaf and dumb. And people believe this stuff. And they drop money for this stuff. It's wrong. All we do is tell people it is okay to ask questions. It's okay to be different. It's okay to question the things that you've grown, you know, you've grown in, you know, you've believed in all your life.
Ahmed says he was paid around $150 by a preacher to pretend to be a man who couldn't walk and then be healed.
The pastor took olive oil. Pray to the olive oil. Just split the olive oil on me. I started, you know, all those things. It's a lie. But the congregation didn't know anything. They were thinking it's a miracle, but to our own side is a business.
He likes to be addressed as Emmanuel, God with us. These people are on an ego trip, and he likes to have the song sung, Emmanuel our God. It's repeated over and over. Whilst driving out a demon, Joshua asked the demon, and who am I? And the demon answered, you are Jesus the Christ. Joshua laughed and called others and said to him, hear what this demon says, I am Jesus. I've seen enough. Did you see how she walked? Like this. What happened when Jesus healed someone? He jumped up and jumped for joy and he was fully healed. This is deception of the highest order. 2 Thessalonians chapter 9 verse 11 reads, "The coming of the lawless one will be in accordance with the work of Satan, displayed in all kinds of counterfeit miracles, signs, and wonders, and in every sort of evil that deceives those that are perishing. They perish because they refuse to love the truth and so be saved." What's the truth? Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. All thy commandments of truth, thy law is truth, Psalm 119. Obedience and Christ, that is the way. Jesus calls us to repentance and a walk with him. And then, you know why? Even if you stayed crippled, you have joy. Because you'll have life eternal and you will not be a cripple on the other side. For this reason, God sends them a powerful delusion so that they will believe the lie. This is God's permissive will. This, you must understand, God's will is God's will, God's permissive will, God's ultimate will. God permits it because they refuse to want him. They want their needs filled. Leave me alone with your repentance. Just give me what I need. And they are served this up in a package which is so delusionary that people believe it, so that they will be condemned who have not believed the truth but have delighted in wickedness. Wolves in sheep's clothing. For God is not the author of confusion but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints. 1 Corinthians 14 verse 33. I would like to make an appeal that we serve Jesus Christ in righteousness and in truth. That we look at our own hearts and say, am I really a good, wonderful person?
$1,000 seed. You may already have the thousand. It may be something you put aside for retirement or a college or a vacation. You may have put some money aside that nobody knows about and God's given you a picture. It may be in the bottom of your closet. It may be in a sock. Maybe between your mattresses. It may be an account that nobody knows about, but you and God. That's not your harvest. That $1,000 won't get you anywhere until God touches it. Everything.
In fact, I have a feeling that somebody watching me right now, I have a feeling that somebody that wants a credit card debt wiped out, that if you'll use your faith as you sow the $1,000 on a credit card, as you use your faith, as you use your faith, God's going to wipe out your credit card indebtedness. It is done. In Jesus' name. It
newspapers had flown helicopters over my house, taking pictures of my house. I didn't know how nice it was till I saw how my enemies saw it. And when I saw what they were looking at, I said, wow, I am blessed. I am blessed. I didn't know how good God had been to me.
Your $1,000 cannot reproduce until it enters into a covenant with the soil. You can put that $1,000. Just the other day I like new money. I don't know if you do, but I hate old money that's wrinkled and dirty and got all the diseases on it. I like new money. And when I give things to people, I like to give stacks of money. It's fun. You ever had a stack of new money? Have you? You have it? Have you?
A little stack.
A little. Oh. And so I made, you know, the big stack where it was brand new, and I like brand new money. I don't want any money around me that's not. I'd almost rather have a new one than an old 20. Now that's kind of dumb, isn't it? But there's something about new money that excites you. You like $100 bills?
Oh yeah, I like new money too.
Oh, most beautiful thing on earth is a $100 bill. I hadn't seen a woman as good looking as a $100 bill. There's something about a $100 bill that excites you. So anyway, I gave it to her just because I did it to my sister. She took off the other day for somewhere, and so as she went to leave, and I went out to her and her husband, I said, sis, I just want to give you a stack of money just to feel good, just to feel good, just stroke it. And he said, we don't give to get something back. Oh, yes, we do. Oh, yes, we do. A man came to me and said, Brother Mike, when I give to God, I expect nothing in return. I said, I wrote a little song for you. How dumb thou art, how dumb thou art.
Something. Adam in the Garden of Eden was God manifested in the flesh.
No denying some people have prospered handsomely.
Wow!
The pastors themselves, they live like rock stars with huge mansions, private jets, and fancy cars.
Oh, yeah!
But when it comes to opulence, few religious leaders compare to Kenneth Copeland.
Amen.
To show you his house, we rented this helicopter so you can see his 18,000 square foot mansion valued at over $6 million.
He lives in this home outside Fort Worth, Texas. It has beautiful water views and comes complete with a boathouse. But that's not all. Copeland is an avid pilot, and here's his pride and joy, a $20 million Cessna Citation jet. It's the fastest private jet money can buy. He said he needed it to better serve the Lord, and proudly did a flyby for his followers after the church bought it.
Shout amen!
But it's not just one plane. We found a fleet of planes registered to the church, and you won't catch him waiting in line at the airport because he's got his own, the Kenneth Copeland Airport, located right next to his mansion.
I think Copeland is unbelievably greedy.
Amen.
She sent them a lot of money, a whole lot of money.
When Christy Parker's mother died of cancer, she found diaries that showed her mother sent Copeland most of her life savings, hoping her faith and donations would cure her of her terminal disease.
What do you think of Kenneth Copeland's lifestyle?
TV doesn't do it justice. Their office furniture is probably worth more than most people's houses. It makes you sick.
Oh, amen.
My lifestyle follows the scripture. We give, we believe, we're open.
You have a fleet of private jets. Why is that necessary? You're a minister. How many private jets do you have?
We're open.
Right after that, he walked away.
Although Copeland says he cooperated with the Senate investigation, the Senate committee disagreed, saying only two television preachers did, Joyce Myers and Benny Hinn. And the committee recommended that the IRS investigate further.
Amen. Amen.
C'è chi ritiene di poter avere un rapporto personale, diretto, immediato con Gesù Cristo al di fuori della comunione e della meditazione della Chiesa. Sono tentazioni pericolose. sono tentazioni dannose, sono...
And if at times our efforts and works seem to fail and not produce fruit, we need to remember that we are followers of Jesus Christ, and his life, humanly speaking, ended in failure, the failure of the cross.
Mature and develop godly character until we learn to live with the all-seeing eye on us all the time. I mean, we're never going to mature and develop godly character until we learn to live with the all-seeing eye on us all the time. I mean,
it's a story that is shocking many Americans on this night. One of the country's most famous Christian pastors is being accused of having sex with members of his church, and not just any members. We're talking about teenage boys he may have met when they were as young as 14, and then, according to the allegations, may have had relationships with them after they turned 16 and above. In a lawsuit, two men in their 20s now are saying the bishop, Eddie Long, took them on trips, gave them gifts, bought them a car, gave them cash, gave them jewelry, all as a ploy to have sex with them, and they say it was the church's money that he was giving to them. His lawyer is denying the allegations, but I want you to listen to some of the most graphic details in this lawsuit, straight from the attorney who shocked many tonight when she stood before cameras and told this story of Eddie Long. Here she is.
There, the pastor started to do what adult pedophiles do with younger people, which is starting to spend time with them, casually watch TV with him and lay his legs on him, and then ask him to massage him, and then start explaining to him how special he was to him, and it was special for the bishop to be able to spend time with them. They did devotional readings together. He was over there on a regular basis at this house. Eventually, it turned into such a relationship that the bishop had a ceremony with Anthony Flagg called a covenant. Within that covenant, it was essentially a marriage ceremony where there was a candles, exchange of jewelry, and biblical quotes given in order for Anthony to know and for the bishop to tell him, "I will always have your back and you will always have mine." He would use biblical stories to talk about how important it was to follow your leader and your master, and let him know that the acts that he was engaged in were not necessarily meaning that he was a homosexual or that either of them was, but rather the pastor, Bishop Long, was releasing his passion and his love for Anthony. Meantime, we have Maurice Robinson, and while Anthony's living in this house, he's bought a Mustang car. He's given money. He is on the payroll of New Birth Missionary Baptist Church, as reflected by the federal tax returns. And he starts to travel with the bishop. He goes to the W Hotel in New York Times Square. He goes to the W Hotel in Dallas, where Anthony specifically remembers that he saw the zoo in town and that he wished he had gone to the zoo. But instead, on that trip, he accompanied the bishop everywhere the bishop went, including sharing a bed in the same hotel room on that trip and many others. They join this church, and the next thing he knows, he starts to immediately get to know the bishop. And the bishop, this is a very handsome young man, very charismatic young man, who wants nothing more to do what a lot of young African-American males want to do, like their idols of being in the music business, perhaps. and he introduces him to famous people. He meets T.I. He meets Chris Tucker. He meets Tyler Perry. He meets all kinds of famous people in the company of Bishop Long. And Bishop Long gives him a car. In fact, Bishop Long lets him drive his Bentley automobile. That's right. Bishop Long has a Bentley, or the church does, whoever owns it, and allows a young man at 17, 18 years old to drive it around. The feeling of power. And he gives him money, and he puts him on the New Birth missionary payroll, which again will be reflected by the 1040 forms that he received. And in fact, Anthony has, just in the accounting and the payroll, over $11,000 of payments on the payroll from New Birth Bishop, New Birth Church, as an employee of a 17 or 18 year old young man. And that's not counting the cash, the gifts, and the trips. He too went on a number of trips, but for Maurice, he was a little bit tougher because his mother and father were both in his life, and yet his mother recounts how the bishop, she thought there was nothing better for her son and their entire life to be handpicked as a personal attendant around the bishop. Crossing the line in which you have sexual contact of any sort with your parishioners, and particularly vulnerable young men that you're supposed to protect. It's our belief that these two are just two of the brave ones who are willing to come forward. And I'm going to tell you now, y'all are going to be chasing them around for interviews, and I'm not putting them through that. For them to sit down and reach out and tell me what happened, and it is the gory details in this complaint of the sexual acts that occurred, is more than enough. And we did not hide their names. This is not a John Doe lawsuit. But at the same time, they don't need to be in front of cameras.
The well-known sex scandal involving Bishop Eddie Long began when four young men, all former members of the New Birth Missionary Baptist Church, filed suit accusing the bishop of lavishing money, trips, and gifts on the young adults while having sexual contact with them.
You are not a man, you are a monster.
The case was finally settled in secret back in May. Sources tell us an undisclosed amount of money was paid to the young men about anything else.
We wanted to ask you about Bishop Eddie Long.
Oh,
no comment.
Come here.
Can we just talk to you for a second?
But I am not the man that's being portrayed on the television.
The well-known sex scandal involving Bishop Eddie Long began when four young men, all former members of the New Birth Missionary Baptist Church, filed suit accusing the bishop of lavishing money.
No, not because they're gay. Everybody, we go to hell because we choose to reject the grace of God. The only way you can go to hell is you reject.
If a gay person accepts Christ,
Jesus Christ, he's going to heaven.
Okay.
Without a doubt.
Okay.
And by the way, if you're not following me on Twitter, you're going to hell.
I'm going to say something going to knock your lights off. God has the power to take life, but he can't. He got the power to do it, but he won't. He's bound. He can't. He says death and life is in the power of whose tongue? Yours. You ready for this? You want something to knock your lights off? You choose when you live. You choose when you die. Death and life's in the power of your tongue, not God's. Now, you got the power, but he will not exercise that because you are a speaking spirit. So he says, speak life. He even tells him, choose life. It's death and blessing, man. Let me help you out. Let me help you. Life.
Tell me, what do you think is the future of Christianity? Well, Christianity and being a true believer, you know, I think there's the body of Christ, which comes from all the Christian groups around the world or outside the Christian groups. I think everybody that loves Christ or knows Christ, whether they're conscious of it or not, they're members of the body of Christ. And I don't think that we're going to see a great sweeping revival that will turn the whole world to Christ at any time. I think James answered that, the Apostle James, in the first council in Jerusalem, when he said that God's purpose for this age is to call out a people for his name. Mm-hmm. And that's what God is doing today. Mm-hmm. He's calling people out of the world for his name, whether they come from the Muslim world or the Buddhist world or the Christian world or the non-believing world. They are members of the body of Christ because they've been called by God. They may not even know the name of Jesus, but they know in their heart that they need something that they don't have, and they turn to the only light that they have, and I think that they are saved and that they're going to be with us in heaven.
This is fantastic. I'm so thrilled to hear you say that. There's a wideness in God's mercy.
There is.
There's a wideness.
The Master had special plans for us.
Why is he holding a picture of Billy Graham? For those of you who have discernment and have studied and are paying attention to the end times deception and the falling away of the faith and all that's been prophesied in the Bible, you know who Billy Graham is and what Billy Graham's all about. He's the greatest Christian deceiver in human history, fulfilling Bible prophecy of the men that are falling away from faith, coming into the churches as wolves in sheep's clothing. If you don't know that, you need to do your research, or you're never going to be able to put these pieces to the puzzle together. I was so convinced by John Ramirez's testimony that I believed that he was a true convert. And in his testimony, he is revealing and disclosing that he was one of the highest level Satanists in the world. And he knew the names of principalities and powers of New York, Miami, Tahiti, Las Vegas, all around the world, the ones and the powers and the angels and the demon forces that controlled Islam and Buddhism and Hinduism and Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons and all these principalities and powers. And he's known them by name. He said he had contracts with them. You can't tell me that this man does not have any knowledge at all about the principalities and powers that work in the churches as false ministers of righteousness. You can't tell me he had no knowledge and the names of those principalities that are working with Billy Graham, the ones that gave Billy Graham his power, his fame, his prestige, and all the opportunities that made him a very famous and rich evangelist. You can't tell me that this man, his high-ranking level of Satanism, and all the names and powers that he was familiar with, and all the contracts that he had no knowledge of the Billy Grahams that are in the world. He's busted. He's busted. And only those who continue to support false teachers like Billy Graham are going to be deceived by these kinds of false Christian converts, such as these Satanists posing as Christians. They are nothing more than ministers of unrighteousness posing as godly men to deceive the masses. Beware of this kind of thing. Pray and fast for wisdom and knowledge and discernment so that you're not sucked into this strong delusion that God's pushing into the world. Only the elect will be spared. People like us who know the truth, who love the truth more than men. Do not be deceived by these things, brothers and sisters. Pay attention.
You better pray that you have the wisdom and discernment of God.
The Master had special plans for us.
Because you're going to need it as armor in these days of mass deception.
The Master had special plans for us.
Pray now. Fast now. Get what you can get from heaven now and strap it on and be ready and alert.
The Master had special plans for us.
Because this is going on in a major way. And I was amazed. I believed him at first. And then praise God, hallelujah, by his grace and mercy. He opened my eyes. He opened my eyes. To see this manipulation. He opened my eyes. 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 What makes you think he can't trick you? He can't trick you. Trick you. Trick you. Trick you. Trick you. Trick you. Trick you.
The master had special plans for us. Nor would I. Special plans for us.
Have you ever wondered what the secret is behind T.B. Joshua's prophecies? Is he speaking the word of God? Is he given these visions from an evil spirit? Or are they just cleverly manipulated and edited to make them appear more accurate than they really are? In this video, we can reveal some of the editing tricks behind T.B. Joshua's prophecies. T.B. Joshua's video editing team are able to use footage of T.B. Joshua to stitch together prophecies to fit events after they happen, by cutting out any inconvenient details that don't fit reality. They present these prophecies as if they were complete and untampered. In this video, we will show you how they work. Let's watch one of his recent prophecy videos, released on May the 12th, 2012, after a plane crash in Indonesia. It starts with an undated clip from a Sunday service.
The picture was so clear. The whole thing was like I'm watching my TV. If I don't see vision clear, I don't talk. I was praying, I saw in Indonesia. I want to advise them, there's a plane coming to the Indonesia, big one, that will carry passenger. I see crash. The color of the plane, I see blue. The picture of the plane was showing me and where it will take off. To the direction when it will happen, and the day and time. I'm seeing Wednesday. I say Wednesday. What will happen Wednesday?
It seems like a pretty clear vision. He mentions several specific details. A crash, a plane coming to Indonesia. The accident happens on a Wednesday. And on May the 9th, an accident happened.
44 passengers has gone missing during a demonstration flight over Indonesia.
It seems impressively accurate. Several details match the event. But here's where it gets interesting. A year ago, Scone released another video. It also predicted a plane crash, also in Indonesia. He's wearing the same black and white shirt that he was wearing in the 2012 video, and his words are at times identical to his new prophecy. It's the same video. Did Scone just reuse the same prophecy for two different disasters? Not quite. Actually, they've done something even sneakier. Let's see what he said back then.
Today now, I was praying, I saw in Indonesia. I want to advise them, there's a plane that will carry passenger. I see crash. The whole thing will start from sea. You will see the whole thing begin to sink. The picture was so clear.
Nobody gets the faithful out of their wheelchairs these days any faster than Benny Hinn. And when Pastor Benny comes to town, no civic center is big enough.
God has just healed her.
Healed her of what, Pastor?
Polio.
This woman who said she had polio and would never walk again, she and her friends say she just climbed out of her wheelchair and walked?
It's a miracle. It's a miracle.
It's unbelievable.
Pastor Benny knows it's great TV, but does he know, does he care if these healings are genuine? Anybody could make up anything.
Someday somebody's going to do that. And probably. What are you going to say then?
I don't know. I can't tell you now. It hasn't happened yet.
Oh, yes, it has. Remember that woman supposedly cured of polio? Pastor Benny knows it made for a great episode of his TV show. He knows it probably helped squeeze even bigger donations from his flock. But there's something he doesn't know.
That woman works for us. Woman doesn't have polio, never did.
Then why did she say she had?
We put her up there to see if he could tell her story was not true, to see if it would matter, to see if he would ever check. So, Benny, is it faith or is it fraud?
I'm still a human being like you. Made many mistakes, big ones, and will still make mistakes. But I really want to do better. I really want to.
The law is this. Here's the law in the kingdom of God. Harvest responds only to seed, not to prayer. Harvest responds only to seed, not to prayer, not to fasting, or any kind of position you have. Harvest only responds to seed. Say that out loud. Harvest only responds to seed, not prayer. Not fasting. Not titles. Seed. Now, don't you go to thinking about, well, no, I don't agree with that because I remember one time I prayed. No, it only responds to seed. All right, keep living. Living this time right now. Ain't no harvest coming because you say, oh, Lord Jesus, you understand. Lord, help me. He said, I do understand. So, don't start all that. So, find you some piece of money. Find you something to sow. If it's money, you need whatever the harvest is you need to come up. If it's money, you're going to have to sow money. You can't talk about, I'm going to sow my time. You're just going to get a vacation. No money. Until the seed is sown, the harvest is not in view. Until the seed is sown, the harvest is not in view.
Phoenix, Arizona, hello.
Hello, Larry. You're the best. Thank you, Joel, for your positive messages and your book. I'm wondering, though, why you sidestepped Larry's earlier question about how we get to heaven. The Bible clearly tells us that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the light, and the only way to the Father is through him. That's not really a message of condemnation, but of truth.
Yeah, I would agree with her. I believe that.
So then that's a Jew is not going to heaven.
No. I
you can.
Well, no, here's my thing, Larry, is I can't judge somebody's heart, you know. I don't know. Only God can look at somebody's heart. And so, I don't know. To me, it's not my business to say, you know, this one is or this one isn't. I'm just saying, here's what the Bible teaches, and I want to put my faith in, you know, in Christ. And I think it's wrong when we go around saying, you know, you're not going, you're not going, you're not going, because it's not exactly my way. I'm not going to be the God.
You believe your way.
I believe my way. I believe my way with all my heart. But
for someone who doesn't share it,
well,
is wrong, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well,
I don't know if I look at it like that. I would present my way, but I'm just going to let God be the judge of that. I mean, I don't know. I don't know.
So you make no judgment on anyone?
No, but
I... About atheists?
No, I just, you know what? I'm going to let God be the judge of who goes to heaven and hell. And I just, again, I present the truth, and I say it every week. You know, I believe it's a relationship with Jesus. But you know what? I'm not going to go around telling everybody else. If they don't want to believe that, that's going to be their choice. God's got to look at your own heart. God's got to look at your heart. And only God knows that.
You believe there's a place called heaven?
I believe it.
So I just want to encourage every one of us to realize when we obey God, we're not doing it for God. I mean, that's one way to look at it. We're doing it for ourselves. Because God takes pleasure when we're happy. That's the thing that gives him the greatest joy this morning. So I want you to know this morning, just do good for your own self. Do good because God wants you to be happy. When you come to church, when you worship him, you're not doing it for God, really. You're doing it for yourself because that's what makes God happy. Amen. Let's open our hearts to him today.
Many is our own mentality. So when you grapple with this notion of many paths to God, there has to be many paths to God because we are many people. And in the process, he reveals himself in many ways.
And he has to reveal at your level, and not everybody's at the same level.
Not everybody's at the same level.
Not everybody's at the same
level. That's absolutely right.
Yeah.
That cross-pollinization that we talked about, that we are strengthened through.
God all over you. I pray his favor. I pray the blood of Jesus will come upon you right now. Keep you in his care. God, I thank you for your blessings.
Talking to Donald Trump, by the way, and Donald Trump is, you know, all about money. And he endorses Paula White. But listen to this.
So we talk about that.
You know, that's the principle I teach, that find your passion in life and figure out a way to make money.
Well, I think that's...
Can you believe that?
Because my Bible tells me that John saw in the book of Revelation a multitude no man could number, of every tongue, of every nation, of every tribe, which no man could number. But nothing is said of that in terms of those who go to hell. It seems like there are more going to heaven. Whoa, hallelujah! And I think this church, this ministry has a lot to do with that.
This is exactly what the scripture meant when it said that people are going to amass to themselves false teachers, having itching ears, no longer wanting to hear sound doctrine. We see these stadiums are packed with people wanting to hear Joseph Prince say that everybody's going to be going to heaven. More people will be in heaven than are in hell. Listen, he does not know that. He doesn't know it, and he doesn't get that from Scripture. Just because there is an absence on the amount of people that are going to be in hell doesn't mean anything. When we look at Scripture, we see that Jesus says in Matthew 7:13-14, "Enter ye in at the strait gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat, because strait is the gate and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it." Now, Jesus' words say, "Few there are that find the gate that leads to eternal life." But broad is the way and wide is the gate that leads to destruction. Why is he saying this? Because there are many, many, many people that are going to reject the true gospel of Jesus Christ and go the way of this world.
I want you to go to the phone, dial the number on the screen, and simply say, "I'm one of the 1,000. I'm going to faith in somehow in 90 days.